flag. There are people in this room that in might not be tomorrow, it might not be in 2 years, it might not even be in five, but there are patterns in your heart or things that you need to submit to the Lord to where if they don't get dealt with, whether repentance, counseling, accountability, it could be just like prayer, like something simple as prayer, that this could maybe happen to you. Yeah. I'm trying to save you a lot of trouble. but that was my remedy. I was like, I'm moving to the beach. I'm going to be a bartender. That was my plan. So I called a buddy of mine that I'd played music with for forever. We went to school together, and him and his wife just so happened to be heading out for 3 weeks, and they had a house at the beach. I said, sweet, I will house sit for you. And they said, okay. So I got half of my wish. I got to move to the beach for 3 weeks, and I thought, well, I don't know if I want to live at the beach. So that dream kind of got squashed for me pretty quickly. So I pitched a fit for a little bit, because that's just what we do when we want to be right about something. That's what I do when I want to be right about something, I should say. So, and then people were calling me left, right, and center. What are you? Are you okay? Are you in sin? Are you addicted to drugs? I'm like, no, because I just up and left. I canceled 50 trips to really well-known places. I quit my job. I mean, literally, it was like one day I just gotten off tour, was doing all these amazing things, and then the next day it was like, Amber went to the beach. We don't know what happened to her. We don't know what happened. So I was getting these phone calls from people, and they're like, Are you okay? Like, do you need to go to the loony bin? I'm like, probably since about 2009. So that boat passed a long time ago. So we're just kind of focused. That was a joke. So I'm mentally sound. I'm okay. 911 is spelled. Some people got that. So I'm getting these phone calls from these people. And I'm having to tell them, I'm like, no, I'm okay. I'm just really tired, and I'm really mad, and I don't know why, and I don't like it, and it's not fair to myself, and it's not fair to the people that are in the events that I'm going to. It's just not fair. So I'm taking some time, and I'm gonna figure this out. But the more I sought the Lord after, you know, I pitched a fit for a little bit, I decided, you know what, let's just see what the Lord has to say about this. I was like, okay, Jesus, what's going on? And he said, I loved you enough to let you get here. And I said, I'm not really sure what that means or if that's biblical. You know, like you're like, kind of do this thing. And he said, the only way for you to understand that you were more valuable than your gifts and your abilities was for you to let them go. And he was like, will you let me show you who you are? And at the time, I was like, I don't know. Because that was the scariest thing for me in the moment. Because, you know, testimony for another time. I'm going to write a book, and it will probably be turned into a Lifetime movie. That's how crazy my life has been. And I am being serious. That was a really, really scary thing for me to be like known, like the intimacy, like that thing was the scariest idea. But it was a thing that I valued the most, which I think, again, is why I decided, oh, music, I can have my cake and eat it too. I could give people just enough. But then if I make it about Jesus, then it's not about me, right? Does that ring true with anybody? Okay. So I really went on this journey, and I think the tax people looked at me like I had 8 heads last year when I turned in my tax returns from 2014, what did that be, 14 or 13?
15.
14. So this was 2 years ago. Okay, so 1 year I had 8 jobs. 8. Because I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do. And I was like, just, okay, well, I want to do this. No, I don't like that. I want to do this. I worked at a restaurant for 4 days. I cried over pasta. I had to memorize this menu, and there was a lot of intricate information about pasta, and I was like, I'm not passionate about stromboli. You know, because in my head, because when I was pitching a fit, I was like, I was just working a restaurant. And I cried over a note card that had a recipe on it. And then I was like, maybe a restaurant, maybe that's not for me. So they looked at me like I was a nut. They like, you have a job. The dude was like, do you have a drug problem? And I was like, do I look like I made enough money last year to have a drug problem? I was just trying to find anything about who I was, and just exploring. And then the Lord was like, here I am, fresh on the earth since 1986. So new model. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Amber Brooks. I'll give you like a tiny little background. If you notice an accent, is because there is one. I've tried to hide it pretty much my whole life. I'm from Alabama originally. I used to say Alabama. Ray Hughes actually moved to the city that I was born in, and I asked him if he moved there on purpose, because that's kind of, you know, because he lives about 30 minutes away from where I grew up, but I come from, like, no red lights, like, creeks, bridge, you know. I grew up on 158 acres of land and spent most of my time running around on four-wheelers and just having fun. So, yeah, it was a lot of fun, and there's not much to do. And that's where I learned how to play music, because I was like, well, I got into some trouble, but I also learned how to play music, and that's kind of where I learned how to worship. And I didn't, even though I didn't really realize that that's what I was doing, I would just kind of hide to escape, to get away and decompress, and I would just sit at my grandmother's piano and just mess around, learn stuff by ear. I was playing, like, picking out notes of Mozart songs by the time I was four, because that's all I wanted to do, was just sit down and write and sit and play and just sit and just sit and just sit. So little did I know that I would become a worship leader. I tell people oftentimes that I felt tricked. How that happened was I turned 18, I was getting ready to graduate high school, and I could have gotten a degree in basket weaving. They just wanted me to go to college. And I said, well, and I'd been listening to Morningstar's worship music. I got saved when I was a teenager, really started walking seriously with the Lord during my late teens, because, I mean, if you've been a teenager, you understand. And so I decided, you know, I found out that they had a school of ministry, because their music and their sounds were just unlike anything that I'd ever heard before. And they agreed to let me go to Morningstar. So I went to Morningstar, and really my intention was, I don't know what I want to do, so I'm just going to go to ministry school. And maybe by then I will hear a thunder from heaven, and then I'll have guidance and practical wisdom into what I'm supposed to do the rest of my life, because that's just the way that I thought. The only thing I knew was, get me out of this little tiny town. And that's just the truth. And so I go to Morningstar, and I know that I love singing. I know that I love writing. I know that I have a heart for the Lord. I'd sang in the youth group a couple of times before, learned how to play guitar, because I wanted to learn how to play another instrument outside of piano. And they have auditions for the worship team. And I'm thinking, I know how to sing harmony. We could work this out. And so I write down on a piece of paper really quickly, and I show up in my, I worked at Applebee's 9 months, whoop, whoop. So I show up in my Applebee's uniform with my little baby Taylor guitar and this song by a girl named Bethany Dillon. I don't know if anybody knows who she is. And so I just sing, come on somebody. Right. So I sing this song in front of Leonard Jones, Paulette Wooten. I think there was somebody else there, but Leonard Jones was like my absolute hero. So when I found out that he was an actual person, I almost like freaked out. I was like, you're like flesh and bone, you exist. And so I sing this song and I audition, and then I go off to my 13-hour shift at Applebee's. And 2 weeks later, I get this phone call from the worship department assistant, and she says, hey, you're gonna be the, hey Jerry, you're gonna be the worship director for band one. Okay. He says, you're going to be the worship director for band one, and I, or the worship leader. And I said, I'm not a worship leader. And they said, well, you are now. Everybody has to write their own songs. Your first set is Tuesday. Click. They hung up on me, and that's how I started leading worship. They just basically said, it's in you. And it actually ended up being really great for me, and it's honestly the way that I learn quickest is usually by doing. So it was really a blessing and really challenging, but I really kind of appreciated the way that that went down. So now we're years later, and here I am still really enjoying it. Was, you know, fortunate enough to be able to make a couple CDs and travel around a lot of places and meet a lot of cool people. But anyway, that's a little bit of my background in a sense of kind of the worship realm area. How many people are like musicians, worship leaders? One, two, a few, just back row, other back row people. I see you.
We all just like you.
You all just like me? Aw, I like you guys too. You guys are cool. How many people just love to worship Jesus?
Everybody.
Not the worship leader. Okay, I'm just kidding. I'm just messing with you. I gotta pick on my kind. So I wanted to, when we hear words like the cost of worship or expensive worship or these kinds of things, it could start a lot of different types of conversations, I think. I have been sort of on a journey where I have learned that in kind of a different and more personal light, and I'll just kind of intersperse between sort of my journey over the past couple of years and some of the things that I believe the Lord has kind of shown me about this subject. And I promise I will get you out of here by 5:15. So God is always after your heart, right? He's always pursuing your heart. He's always after your heart. And we know that in heaven there's not going to be any tears. There's not going to be any anger, sadness, sickness. He's going to, you know, there's going to be these streets of gold and sapphire all over the place and angels, you know, throwing stuff and crowns everywhere and songs and just roar, and it's just going to be great. Who would find it having a hard time worshiping in that kind of situation?
Nobody.
No. You probably look around and be like, what in the world is going on? This is kind of cool, but I find it really hard to believe that anybody would have to sacrifice a song or sacrifice an offering of worship unto the Lord in that kind of situation. They call it a sacrifice of praise because it costs you something, right? And the kind of worship, Bill Johnson talks about this too, and is brilliant. He's like, the kind of worship that you can give unto the Lord when you are experiencing trials and hardships is more precious to the Lord, because now is the only time that you'll be able to offer that to Him. What does it really mean to offer up to the Lord something that's costly? I think it's more than, you know, practice time and cool lyrics, even though it is, you know, the sound and the creativity and worship that I feel is coming, and the way that things are crafted and said. I feel that there's absolutely anointings on people to get that in the secret place, but I'm talking like, what if He's after something deeper than your practice time and your ability to write a cool song? Even though we all like writing cool songs. I like writing cool songs, makes me feel good, right? But what if there's something that's really, really more to the story? I found myself, being in a place where I almost kind of idolized art. And if you're a creative person, sometimes it's easier to recognize the coolness of your gift, right? As opposed to praising the Lord for the fact that you have that gift to begin with to reach other people. And there just really, really is a process in kind of understanding how to reconcile understanding what a sacrifice of praise really means. Because I really believe that at the end of the day, it's all about your heart. and how your heart is. And that has been one of the hardest lessons that I've had to learn over the past couple of years. It's been terrible. Because, I mean, it will kill you. And it's the truth is that there are two people always out there trying to kill you, the enemy and God. They're both trying to kill you. They're both trying to kill your flesh. The only difference is when you let God kill you, he resurrects things back to life that need to come back, and he keeps the things in the grave that needed to stay there.
Amen.
Right? So if you're going to die, someone will get you. But you get to choose who that is.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think Reinhard Bonnke said it like this: if you bury a seed, it will rise. And that's why the grave couldn't hold Jesus. If you bury the truth. If you bury a lie, it will rot. If you bury a truth, it will rise. And that's why the grave couldn't hold Jesus down. So the idea of a sacrifice of praise in my mind in the costly worship is almost, in this context, and what I have learned personally, is saying yes to God, just going, die. Anything in there that is not of me, any kind of selfish ambition, any kind of hiding behind your gifts, any kind of hiding behind your super spirituality to make yourself look more important than you are, you know, if the pain in your heart supersedes the super spirituality that you're trying to give on the outside, like how do you reconcile that? How many times have I personally hid behind my talent, or the fact that I'm funny, or the fact that I go to church a bunch and know a bunch of scriptures, you know? And I'm like, why do we? Is everybody okay? First
yeah.
of all, okay. Why do we do this to ourselves as creative people, as artists? Like, it's like we so long to be known, but we're so scared to be known at the same time. And the only person or thing that we can, that who can actually know us and actually does know us before the foundations of the world formed us in our mother's womb, breathed his breath into us, and we're like hiding behind our ability to write songs that make us feel good about ourselves. Ask me how I know. I've done it. I did it. I didn't do it on purpose. I never thought, okay, I'm just gonna write something that I don't mean, and I'm gonna get people to sing it, and then people are gonna lift their hands, and then I'm gonna go home. It was never like that. But I didn't realize that when I was writing, that he was kind of drawing me deeper into this thing where it's like, let me know you, let me know you. I'm after your heart. I'm not after your talent. I like your talent, but I would rather kill that thing in you so that I can have your heart and then give it back to you in a resurrected way. And that's exactly what he did to me. He drug me through the mud kicking and screaming. I could have said no, and I tried to. And I managed to become a Grammy Award winning songwriter and basically have a nervous breakdown within 12 months of each other. It was actually pretty impressive. And it was because I kept just trying to hide behind what I was doing, this thing that I created in myself. And he was after my heart so much, but I knew that my talent could get me in the door of anywhere I wanted to go. So I would be gone up to 300 days a year because the Lord was like touching things in me that I didn't want to get messed with. Really what he was trying to do is he was trying to kill that need to run away in me. He was killing that thing in me that said, well, in order to be loved, I have to offer up something that is like pretty and shiny and well put together and crafted, you know, in a certain way that will be acceptable unto the masses. That was my idea of a sacrifice of praise. Well, if I practice really, really hard and come up with some weird chords and say something in a different way, then praise the Lord. If I raise my hands when I'm in a bad mood, sacrifice of praise. I wonder if a sacrifice of praise for right now, like, I just wonder if it's letting him see who you are regardless of what kind of face you're trying to put on. And you're just like, hey, this is me and all of my meanness. He made me this way. I've heard it said, you know, talking about the omniscience. Is it omniscience, the knowing, all-knowing thing? Thank you. That's my scholar reference over here, right here. Yeah, no, yes. Adam's mom's here to make sure that I don't cuss.
That would be the
plot
call, the cattle
block. I know. We're accountability buddies. He said, he said that people have done a study, and he says that omniscience, they're starting to see maybe that it's not that he has the ability to like read your mind and know everything, but that he chooses to withhold that ability, because if he could read your brain, that would take away the idea of choice and the thought of relationship. So they're starting to say that maybe the omniscience of God means that he has the ability and is capable of getting inside of your mind and being like, okay, this is what you know, and just all of these kinds of little intricate thoughts, but he withholds that to inspire a relationship. That was free. That was free. But so there's always, referencing like with if you're going to let the Lord, you know, kill you. It's a harsh word, I'm sorry. But if you let the Lord just really mold you, kind of like what we were talking about earlier, really mold you and really take the parts of your life and just kind of do this padding and spinning and, you know, everything just kind of looks chaotic. But he's the God of the resurrection, right? And whenever there's a death in God, there's always a resurrection and there's always an exchange. You see that when you know, Paul to Saul, you know, whenever a man gets changed by God, he gets a different name. Mm-hmm. So it's almost like that old person is dead now. Okay, you're no longer Jacob, you're Israel. You're no longer Saul, you're Paul now. You're no longer Abram, you're now Abraham. So there's always an exchange and there's always an increase. You might walk out of the situation with a little bit of a limp, but you're not going to be the same kind of person that you were before, right? So like in Exodus 33:20, you know, when the scripture says that you cannot see my face and live. I would like to humbly submit to you that that's not what God meant. Because if that were true, what did Jesus say? If you've seen me, you've seen. Right? So that means that anybody that Jesus looked at would have dropped dead. He would have had the worst full-time ministry ever. Everybody this guy runs into dies. It's the craziest thing. So I wonder, you know, because he didn't say, if you see me, I will kill you. He said, you can't see me and live. You can't see my face and live. So I'm wondering if what he was saying was, you can't see me and live the way that you have been. You can't see me and stay the same. You cannot see my face and choose to do the things that you have been doing the way that you've been doing them. No man can see my face and live.
Be the same.
Right? Yeah. Is this making sense?
Yeah.
Is this helping anybody?
Yeah.
I've just been more on like a heart kick lately, because I think that that's sort of the kick that God has always been on, and I'm just now starting to get on the train a little bit. So there's always this exchange. So if you have a Bible, let's just talk for a minute. John 4. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Okay. It's a big Bible. Hmm. So this is about the woman at the well. We've all heard the story. So I'm just going to read it real quick, starting in verse 1. Whoops, I think I just smashed this little microphone thing. Sorry, Jacob. It's just for you. We're going to see how... So this thing has been going down, so we're going to start it here, and we're going to see how far I get in the chapter before it's all the way down to where it was, all right? It's like a little game. All right, don't pay any attention to me. I'm just having fun. All right, so starting in verse 1, it says, "Therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made him baptize more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize but the disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee, but he needed to go through Samaria." Now, Samaria was like the don't go through there if you're a Jew kind of place. Avoid it at all costs. Literally, people would go as far away around Samaria as they could because they just didn't want to go through there. So Jesus decides, because he's Jesus, he's going to go straight through there. And it says, so he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of the ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now, Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat thus, by the well, New King James. It was about the sixth hour, and a woman came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. When the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself as well as his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water I shall give him will never thirst, but the water I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." Hey, look at that.
You got down to 17.
Got down to 17, I did. That was as far as I was planning on going anyway, so that was the timing of Jesus. So there's a few things that have always kind of puzzled me about this whole scenario, if you'll kind of walk with my train of thought for a minute. That could be dangerous, so don't stay here too long. You'll get lost in the swirl. So Jesus is... thirsty, he's thirsty. His disciples kind of went off somewhere to get food, right? He needs to go through Samaria to get to the next place that he's going. He decides to park it at a well, and he didn't bring a bucket. And he just sits there. It's not like there's water fountains kind of accessible all over the place. So if there's a well in the middle of somewhere, there's going to be a bunch of people coming back and forth and back and forth. So if he's thirsty, that means that he's seeing all these people come to the well with their little thing, and he's seeing them come back and go away. I don't know how many people went to that well, but I would suggest, or I would, if I had to guess, I would think probably more than just that lady came. So, in like modern day terms, this is basically what Jesus did. So pretend like I'm standing in the kitchen. And I'm standing next to the refrigerator, right? I'm just kind of standing there. And say, what's your name?
Sana.
Say Sana walks into the kitchen. I'm like, "Hey, you trying to make me a sandwich?" That's essentially what Jesus does with this lady. He says, "Hey, why don't you get me a drink?" And so they're just having this... I love Jesus. He's just one of those, like, what are you doing? You know? And then it always ends up being amazing and life-changing, and people just get their minds blown and, you know, walk off forever changed. But he's sitting at this well that was named after Jacob. We all know who Jacob is in the Bible, right? Jacob, and by that point, yeah, there's Jacob. That's Jacob right there. Jacob's right there. So Jacob was like this scallywag, scoundrel, you know, just lying, thieving, deceiving guy. And he's the one that wrestled with it. I don't know if it was God. I don't know if it was an angel. I'm not smart enough to uphold an argument in court over that, and I don't want to die on that sword. He wrestled with something that broke his hip. And it wasn't, and it was definitely, you know, something from God. And his name got changed. And it was very specific that this is now who he is referred to. Israel now. He's been named Israel. And even when Jesus is talking about, you know, the forefathers of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. It wasn't called Israel's well. It was called Jacob's well. So that always kind of puzzled me. Why didn't they change everything that was kind of built about the guy? You know, if he had this like life-altering encounter, you know, why are we identifying with the scoundrel and not the new redeemed clean guy? You know. Well, it makes me happy because it shows that Jesus isn't afraid of our mess. But Jesus was sitting at this well that represents change. He represents the redemptive quality of the sacrifice of offering something to Jesus, right? So he's sitting at this well that represents change, and this lady is coming, and Jesus, before you know it, he ends up prophesying over it, like, where is your husband? Oh, you have five husbands. These truths and all this stuff, and talking about living water that will flow out of, you know, that you'll never thirst again. And he was inviting her to reach into and dip into the well that represented change and offer it to the only person that could change her in that moment. Just the offering of to him, like going through, you know, so that's really a prophetic representation in my mind. Because in that moment, he went out of his way, sat, probably was thirsty as mess, because he wanted to encounter this one person. But he required something of her, and it had everything to do with her heart, and not her gift, and not her talent, and not her ability. It was really hot up here. It's those lights, man. Is this making sense? Yeah. If it's not, and if I'm confusing somebody, and just, well, sorry. Yeah. I'm confused too. But really, this really is a season where, and it's not even a season. Well, actually, it is a season. It's a season of acceleration in the Lord really being after who you are as opposed to what you think that you can offer him. Because the reality of it is, God does not need your help. He could go, and we would all go, poof. He could stop thinking about you and you would cease to exist. He doesn't need our help. But he loves us so much, and he wants a relationship with us so much. So much, so much. He is willing to do anything for us to be like, oh, right. It's really about you. So what happened to me was I was focused so much on my ability, my talent, my songwriting, my thing. I was so caught up in ministering for Jesus that I forgot to minister to Jesus, because it's kind of out of that place where you really get kind of, it's like this divine exchange all over and over and over again. Like after you sort of realize the way not to do something, you're like, maybe I should try something different. And then it's just this kind of overflow, and then he flows back into you, and you flow out, and it flows back into you. And like when you minister to Jesus, it never wears you out. But I was ministering for Jesus, and it pretty much took me into a tailspin of, I just crashed and burned. I just got off tour somewhere. This was 2 years ago. I think I was on tour overseas, and then I got back, did two conferences, and then something in me just broke, and I walked into, I was doing, so part-time traveling, and then part-time I was helping establish a worship department at a church in Raleigh, And I walked into the pastor's house, and I just sat down, and I'm just crying. I'm like, I can't do it anymore. I can't do this anymore. I can't do it anymore. I was like, because at that point, I was just so angry, because I just figured out everything that I could get mad about. I was like, I'm going to get mad about this. I'm going to be cynical about that. Jesus loves me. This I know. I hate blah, blah, blah. You know, just super, super angry and cynical. And just, I was just mean about it all because I'd worn myself out because I'd forgotten why I was even doing it in the first place. So the conversation sort of soon turned into, that's it. I'm going to be a bartender, and I'm moving to the beach. Literally, I said that. She, like, my friend Kathy, she was in there. She was one of the pastors at the church. It's like, I'm bartending on the beach. I'm moving to the beach. I'm gonna serve people liquor, and that's what I'm going to do. For the rest of my life, I'm going to sit on the beach. I'm going to drink beer. Because that's a brilliant choice. Right?
Great retirement,
yeah. And it was kind of getting close to summertime, you know. It's like prom season, open season for that kind of choice. But that's just where I had found myself getting. And I'm sharing this with you because I really... So it was a good 6 months before the Lord was just kind of like, hey, are you going to stop yet? Are you done? And I was like, yeah, okay, let's do it. I'm done. So was really intentional about digging in the scriptures, like spending a lot of like really personal time with the Holy Spirit. Anytime I would pick up my guitar, I wouldn't pick it up to write anything. I would just pick it up to sing. And just learning how to fall in love with the gift of music over again and not necessarily what I can make music do for me. Went to a lot of inner healing. Praise the Lord for stuff like RTF, Sozo, all that stuff. I highly recommend it. Even if you think you don't need it, you need it. I promise. Until we are face-to-face with Jesus, we're always going to have something swirling around in there. Save yourself a headache. Just go. Just punch it in the face. Life is too short to run around and somehow acquire 8 W-2s in 6 months. That is crazy. But I did it.
Part of the process.
Part of my process, yes. So I just kind of came full circle, decided that, and this really was the Lord. I always told the Lord, I said one day, I think it would be super fun to work in a medical field, but I don't like blood. How are we going to make this work? And then a friend of mine, a good friend of mine, used to work for an eye doctor for like 9 or 10 years, and she was talking about it one day, and I said, eyeballs don't bleed. This is great, you know. And so I decided, so I just kind of go through Craigslist and the Indy and just looking around, and there, from a mile from where I was living, this guy was hiring optometric technicians. And so it was like glasses, contacts, anything from glaucoma to macular degeneration, everything in between. I didn't have to stab anybody or take a vial of blood. I was interested. It was the medical field. I knew I wasn't kind of released yet. You don't work, you don't eat. I wanted to be responsible kind of thing. And I didn't want to drain my savings account because I like being smart with money. So I walk into this doctor's office and I hand in my resume, which has absolutely nothing on it that would impress these people at all, right? If I were to walk into a mega church and been like, hey, they would have been like, hey. But eye doctor's office, I'm like, I led worship here for however long I have two, you know. They looked at me like I was nuts. And then 2 days later, I get this phone call. Hey, we would like to interview you. So, okay. And, you know, how much experience do you have in the medical field? None. I've been to the doctor before. I had the flu once when I was 8. That's all I got. And they said, well, that could be. If I have another breakdown, you might see me on the comedy show.
Stand up
all the way. Come on. And they said, well, what interests you in the medical field? It's cool. I mean, I was much more. I was honest with them. I'm like, I have absolutely no experience. I would love to learn how. Some people go to school for this. Some people, I don't know. I'm a fast learner. I'm a hard worker. Blah blah blah. We sat in there for like an hour, and there were five people behind me getting ready to interview. And I'm thinking, and okay, this is never gonna happen. 2 days later, I get a phone call. Hey, can you start on Monday? I said, sure. So for a year, I worked in the medical field as an optometric technician, dealing with, you know, the medical 80% medical stuff, and then 20% of the boring stuff, which is contacts and glasses, which are fine, but, you know, I was stuck between the Jesus heal them and this is really cool, you know, like medicine is just really cool. So I'm doing that, and I'm still learning to just worship the Lord. Like every day, you know, I'd put on my scrubs and, you know, just knowing in the back of my head, like all the stuff that I had accomplished and all the stuff that I was doing, and kind of grieving that loss a little bit, because I really did love it. And I was like, okay, Lord, I worship you more than I worship. And I'm going to give you my worship in my scrubs, walking through the hallways of this doctor's office while I work up all these patients, you know, and just learning how to worship the Lord, knowing that I wasn't walking in my calling. Because I knew, even though I got tricked into leading worship, you know how when you get tricked into something and you're like, this is actually what I was born to do. So I'm walking through the halls in my scrubs, knowing that I'm called to lead worship, knowing that I'm called to write songs that are going to change nations and shift generations, knowing that I'm going to have this, knowing that I'm going to do that, and having all these promises in the back of my head, and all I hear are the swishes of my scrubs that look like nothing that I'm walking in the moment. I'm like, how in the world? I'm like, well, at least I'm not on the beach slinging liquor. Praise the Lord, I got out of that little fit, you know. Silver lining. Although I could use a drink right now, because what am I doing? You know, this is real talk. So I'm learning. So just pacing the wall, like just always whistling. My coworkers would be like, why do you whistle all the time? I'm like, I don't know. My great grandmother did it. Maybe that was it. And it was just, you know, and I've met a lot of really fascinating and interesting people, but I learned how to get my song back walking the halls of the doctor's office. Learning the sacrifice of praise. That was a sacrifice of praise for me. So I was like, I don't know what the heck is going on, but I learned how to worship again to the swishing sound of my scrubs. They were really comfortable too. I kept a pair. And then so finally one day I'm walking into the office, you know, got my little key, I go in. I'm round in the corner. I'm the first one there per the usual, which is fine. I work with great people, but I'm habitually early. I'm just one of those people. If you tell me to meet you at 4, I'm in your driveway at 3:30, and I'm just sitting there. Yeah. I'm that person. So if you ever invite me to your house, just tell me like the time that you actually want me there, 30 minutes earlier than you do, and then we'll figure it out. So I'm rounding the corner, and then all of a sudden I hear, "What are you doing here?" And I stop, and I'm like, hello? Like literally, like to the point, it was so loud and it was in my head to the point where I thought I heard it. I thought, what? And I live in Raleigh now. And the Lord said, I didn't move you to Raleigh to work for an eye doctor. What are you doing here? I thought, going to work. At least I'm not on the beach slinging liquor. You know, like, so this is, and then I thought, oh my goodness, I'm supposed to quit my job. Oh no. And then I did the thing that I only knew how to do, because I didn't want to be one of those, the Holy Spirit told me to quit my job so that I could play Xbox all day. Like, so I'm calling, raise your hand if you know somebody like that. I'm serious. If you know somebody like that, help me, Jesus. Whew. Don't even get me. That's another story for another day. Ooh, now, so I pick up the phone. The first person I call is my pastor. I'm like, this is what I think I heard Jesus say. And he says, well, What would you do?
I don't know, but this is what I feel like I heard the Lord say. And he says, well, he said, don't do anything now. He said, why don't you pray, get other people to pray with you, and then we could talk about it later. After a little bit, I'm like, okay. So I didn't call people that were my age. I didn't call people who were younger than me. I didn't call people who had less life experience than me. I called people who were older than me. I called people who had more wisdom than I do. I called people who are like 70 years old, lived life, made a bunch of mistakes. If you want advice, do not call people your age. They will commiserate you, and they will tell you all the stuff that you want to hear because they want to be your friends so that you can commiserate together about all the bad decisions that you talk to each other into making. Do not call somebody your age if you need advice. That was also free. So I text, I call a bunch of people. Like, this is what I feel like the Lord said. Am I crazy? I don't want to do, you know, what am I doing? And they all, every single one of them told me, they were like, yeah, we actually feel like that's right on. And then I thought, oh, no. Because it would have been easier if they were like, no, Amber, you're crazy. But because I had prayed about it and took it to the Lord and asked people that I trusted and people who were intercessors and really hear from the Lord, they were like, yeah, we feel like your season to step back in is now. Because I'd kind of wrestled for about 6 months of being like, I want to get back in this. And the Lord was like, not yet. And then one day, boom, hey, you need to quit your job. And so I walk into the doctor's office one day after dragging my feet for another month because it scared me so much. And I had dinner with his family at his house. Like, we would watch football games. Like, we're friends. Like, he's not my boss. Like, we're buddies. So I walk into his office. I said, hey, you got a minute? He's like, yeah, sure, sit down. It's like, all right. So I sit down, and we're chit-chatting football. He's a Steelers fan. I'm from Alabama, so we're talking smack to each other. It's fun. And then he says, hey, what's up? And so I kind of gave him this prepared speech that I had. I'm not really good at quitting jobs. I never have been, even though I had 8 W-9s and 1 in 6 months. I never got fired from any of them either. I don't ask me. If
go
you
girl.
Do what?
Go girl.
Yeah, that's right. I've never been fired. So I walk in, and I give him my little speech, and he says, you know, he gave me a bunch of compliments and all these kinds of things, and he said, you know what? So you are an amazing employee. I knew you'd be great. You're a quick learner. But I was starting to wonder what you were doing here. And if he were to be a spirit-filled believer, I'd have been like, Jesus told me the same thing about 2 months ago, and I've been sitting on my hands. So I gave him my 1 month notice. And the whole time I'm like panicking because, you know, like, even though sometimes you hear a word from the Lord, part of your flesh still goes, is this real? So by the grace of the Lord, that happened September. It is now March? March 4th, you know. So it's now March. And so, yeah, so I resigned in September, and the Lord just graciously kind of brought me back into this process. And I feel like $1 million because I took 2 years of just really being like, okay, Lord, learning like what a sacrifice of prayer, like what expensive worship really was. And it had nothing to do with my musical ability at all. So what I want to do, if you just want to stand up, real quick, there's no like, we're not gonna have any tinkering in the background, so sorry. No worship music in the background. Tinkering, no worship tinkering. So let's just close your eyes for a little bit. Let's just be like really vulnerable, but close our eyes and bow our heads so that nobody feels ashamed. I like people feeling safe. If you feel like you may be one of those people where it's like, you know what? I'm pretty close to the place that
you reached, you being me. And I don't know if it's going to be tomorrow, 1 year from now, or 5 years from now, but unless I change my thought processes about who I am or let the Lord get a hold of my identity, this is going to be potentially, eventually, a problem. And it's going to cost me more than the Lord ever asked me to give. If you could just lift your hand and just put it down quick, just so that I could see. Cool. Yep. Awesome. Good. Come find me secretly after, and we could talk more one-on-one. Let me just pray for you guys real quick, kind of as a group. So Jesus, I just thank you for who you are and for everything that you sacrificed so that we could give you ours, our worship, our praise, our adoration. And it's not something that you demand of us. It's something that we have the privilege and the honor to do. And Lord, I just ask that we would just really have a heart posture of ministering to you and to your heart and to your people, and not ministering for you out of our own strength and out of our own cute ideas, out of what might be looking sexy or popular at the time, but that we would really, really tap into the heart of what you're doing and in who you are, and that we place our identity in you and not in our talent, not in our ability to look good or make other people sound like something. We're just really, really after your heart. And I just bless my friends to feel released to be vulnerable and intimate in the hardest ways, in safe areas, you know, like with pastors or leaders that you trust. And just really to cultivate a culture of vulnerability and honesty and brave communication.
Yep.
So that, you know, thank you, Lord, for what happened to me, but if I can help somebody not have to experience that, that would be awesome. So the things that made sense, I asked would go deep into their heart. The things that didn't make sense, don't let them post it on Facebook. And that you would just really, that you really would just kind of, you know, whatever I said that didn't make sense or was wrong, just that you know how to separate the bone from the marrow. And I just thank you for just what you're doing. And for the invitation of breakthrough in the heart.
Yes.
Breakthrough in the heart.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.